nobody's ever said noir. I mean, there is some drama going on, and there is some theatrics. There is a mistake.
Well, I'm more interested in the emotional components, like of distrust, rejection, threat. That's kind of film noir focuses. So,
my paintings have that.
Your paintings have a lot of that, but
my paintings definitely have a lot of that. That's such a beautiful description of noir. That's so good. That's noir.
Okay, we can buy me dinner later. But seriously,
it's true. In this particular show, I mean, even the title. You know, I thought about it through the lens of, it's not Hitchcockian. People who don't, you know, the collective memory is about 5 minutes old, I don't even understand. But through the lens of difference and crime and punishment, the Dostoyevskian notion. I mean, the guys, noir is endlessly fascinating. And in this show, I mean, even my title, I was hoping for a sort of Wagnerian endlessness. But I was hoping for...
Well, okay, you mentioned the title, Everything Once.
Everything Once, so... Exactly. That's noir. Everything is a constant. Cause and effect.
Right.
And that's... And my paintings, all of these are cause and effect.
But I guess what the title also reveals is that you don't really stay too long with the paintings. You don't let them kind of hang around. You like to finish it.
Yes, absolutely.
And that's true, is it?
Yeah, no.
Because some are...
I'm brisky. Yeah,
you're quite brisk.
I'm brisky.
Brief. Yeah, it's brisk. And because some other painters, they can... the gestation period for a work could be years,
Well, look at Susan Archer.
Well, yes, Susan Archer is a very good example.
She's a phenomenal painter.
But I want to... Yeah, go on. Finished.
I don't know much about her practice, but she has a phenomenal rate of production. I mean, she's...
Yes.
Con, we're missing the point with that question. The point is sincerity. I mean, the shadow, noir is shadows.
Mm.
And how deft can you be when darkness is falling? That's the key to painting, in my view, and that's why I like Suzanne's work. How, particularly the sort of more atavistic lifestyle stuff, how deft and adroit and how quick can we be with the painting? That's how I'm different about that. I paint them. Maybe I'll go back to them in 3 years. I don't know. Get it down. Come on, get it. Lay it down.
Okay. You've kind of mentioned the idea of freedom not being inhibited. Do you think about notions of freedom when you're kind of painting? Is it a principle that drives the work?
I do. And that's when other artists become really intrinsic to my idea of constructing a tradition.
So I guess it's about staying away from, pushing conventions.
Yeah, I look at other artists and I just go, you're boring fuck. that's a motivator. I'm not going to succumb. I'm not going to repeat myself. I'm going to, oh God, please, no. So that's where the personal and the abstract combine, that kind of idea of a practice. I don't know any artists who don't look at other artists. Do you?
Oh, no, I and I would question the fact that you also have a lot of influences and that kind of stretch from the Renaissance to contemporaries.
Yeah.
And you.
Yeah. You want to talk about that?
Well, I think it's important to know, you know, who's influencing you now. I don't want to go through the stream of other influences because you know, there's Picasso.
Who's influencing you now?
Yeah, who's influencing you now?
Who's influencing my painting?
Your paintings, who you're thinking about?
Who I'm thinking about.
See, well, you mentioned Nolan.
Yeah, well.
And you know, Picasso was a favourite.
Nolan and Picasso, we get over murdered.
And you mentioned a late.
That's his change. That's his change for anybody.
Well, you mentioned Adam Cullen.
Yeah, he's still. We were very close. And he still occupies my thoughts.
So, in a way.
But we're talking about a profession. I mean, we're talking about painting, right?
Yeah, of course.
And it's a profession. And I am so ruthlessly unprofessional.
I would question that.
That's what you're doing now. Okay. So. Yeah, Adam, I'm still thinking about Adam.
But I want to kind of bring it back to these sort of painting references and how they actually help you with the painting of the day. Do they come in or do they stay?
No, okay, all right. No, okay. Yeah. I understand. Okay. I think it's a profession, and with any profession you have the definition. Not the literal, but the real definition of professionalism, to my mind, is you get better at what you do. That's professionalism, every time you get better. Now, I'm a painter, so sometimes you get worse and you have to live with that.
Yeah.
You actually have to. So who's occupying my thoughts? Well, I'll give you a rundown. Okay, I like Phil James as a painter. I think he's really good. He's really funny. But with his work, with Phil's work, you're left with residue. So what I look for now is, what are you leaving? What do you leave me with? Because, for instance, like, tell you thousands. Okay, no, that's not time.
Just keep it positive.
But Phil James I like very much. I like Glenn Barclay's pots. You know, he's become repetitive and silly, but he's only nurturing his
vocabulary.
Yeah. So he's got a lot of experience. And you see, this is where I view, and I've stayed away from art fairs, in conjunction with my dealer, Tim. I've stayed away from art fairs in a really fundamental way, because they corrupt and distort your practice. You know, you see stuff in an art fair, and that's where somebody, what we're talking about now, is you get to see all that stuff, but it's an art fair, it's not a real hot show.
Yeah, but I think leave that sort of platform, and then let's come back to the influences. Like, are there other
influences? Yeah. Oh shit! Yeah. Okay.
Because you mentioned Suzanne Archer and her recent.
No, I just like to practice very much. Okay. I admire greatly Lindy Ivey. I mean, the sculpt.
Yeah.
I think she has real lethal venom in her life. And her ex-husband, Bruce Armstrong, I admire her honestly. So there's those two. But painters, I really like. I really like Emily Coco, frankly. I just think she's a great painter. Yeah, she needs a roller and all that, but still works.
But Okay, perhaps...
They're influences. Bruce Lee and the influences.
Yes. Because you also mentioned the other day Dora La. Her photographs.
Yeah, I love them.
Yeah.
Very much. Yeah, the destruction. I can't stop looking at photographs, actually.
Dora La's
photographs. They're very hard to find, too. I've only seen about 19, like, eyeball.
Yeah.
I mean, she's great. You know, the destruction. She does these kind of alpine landscape. You know, this supposed castle.
Yes.
This supposed weeping woman. And she does this. You know, she's this destroyed woman who was given a shatter as a disco. And the paintings too. You might find an interesting link there with Tim McGuire. He also very much enjoys the paintings. He did a whole series of that.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Well, they're kind of cloud scopes. And Tim and I, so she's influential for me. I think of her as a scorpion. Maybe. Picasso was ever the same after her, I think.
Yeah, look, I think I just want to ask one last question, and perhaps there will be questions from the audience.
I think they're done tonight.
The studio, all these works have been created in the studio. You're never outside, are you? It's always inside. It's always inside.
Not playing that, no. I'm a studio artist. I'm in my four walls. To make a painting, I can't. I had a laugh last night. I was out for dinner with a very accomplished, successful young painter, and she said,
this is going to be positive, isn't it?
It's so positive. It's nature.
It's
nature.
Okay.
She said, I've just got this new studio. And then, there's like a guy comes in and like he's like critiquing stuff, and I'm like, oh, this one's like finished, dude. What do I do? I said, sleep with him.
You are. There it is. Yes, indeed. Look, I think.
There it is, right there.
I think we'll leave it at that. I want to put it out to you. Do you have any questions?
Can I ask you about, you talk about fragmentation of memory, but when I look at your works, it's almost philosophical, and you said portraiture is it. I wanted to know about this idea of a conditionality of truth as opposed to memory.
No, there's no truth.
There's no truth. That's a conditional thing then.
No, that's exactly a great question. And listen, Craig, I think it's my truth. You know, I get fucked. That's my prerogative. No, it's about prerogatives.
Mm.
And it's about extension. And I'm glad you picked up on the fragmentary nature of memory. Everybody, my job as a painter, as I view it, is not to suddenly distance myself from things. Just go, that happened, and I don't give a fuck about it. It's all right. No, my job is to get involved.
I'd actually almost said opposite though. Yours, it's almost sticky.
No, you're trying to imply that there's an intellectual framework. And
there's not?
No, there is not.
So it's intuitive?
No. Don't be confused, Greg. It's memory. It's called memory. And it's malleable and flexible and fluid. And it's at your control. It's a device. And it's the device I choose to use as painter. And of course, it's when I say fragmented, I say it's inflected by a necessary darkness or whatever, but you know, there's no, they're not confrontational paintings. I've never, they are, I think Craig, to answer your question, I think people who live with my painting, after a while, they realise, oh, this isn't just a happy jar of flowers. So the slow release of things, I'd like to think, to answer your question perfectly and properly, I think at their best, my paintings are capable of creating perhaps that 5 meter perimeter. They exist on their own in the world.
Except to pick up on your point.
I wasn't being duplicitous.
No, I think that's a little bit misleading because the memories are also based on events. They're about relationships.
Yeah, but the intellectual structure is not right. Legitimate.
Yeah. Okay, all right.
Just because I'm smart doesn't make
well,
it cool.
It must be difficult for your genius.
My question is, the key to every drama, I guess, is conflict. And I think I can speak for most of us. We've loved the interplay between you two. So thank you for a wonderful interview. And secondly, very important question.
That was interplay.
Yeah. Secondly, very important question is did she?
You are really, you know, you're really naughty.
That's
very mischievous.
So, no, it's not, actually. This is fundamentally stupid. Okay, I said, sleep with me. Yes, it's true. And she went, I don't know.
Do we do it? Is there anyone else would like to make a comment or have a question to McLean? Oh, yes.
Hi, what's your name?
Charlie.
Hi, Charlie.
Craig.
Yes. I'll give you that $20 later.
look, thank you all. Oh, sorry, Jeremy.
Does alcohol help or hinder?
Now that's a tough question.
My thing. It's my thing. Yeah. Well, I used to get drunk a lot with the great Tim Sorrell, up until recently, actually. He was my drinking partner. Well, I was his drinking partner. And Tim and I used to talk about the complex nature of alcohol. And I've resumed that abbreviated discussion with my dealer, Tim. And we talk about it a lot, but in essence, the old adage rings true. You go to bed a hero, and you wake up a fucking idiot. I've never painted a picture drunk. No. Oh, well, there was one, really good one. And so I thought I could do it again, but you can't. I think that's what you're asking. You can't paint when you're drunk. But as a hindrance? No, I've never found it. In any way providing an excessive deficiency in other people who interest me.
Okay, I think I want to thank you all for standing up for what was 55 minutes and 39 seconds. So thank you for doing that, and I hope you got a little bit more out of this conversation for the words around here. Please thank McLean Edwards for the conversation.